have come to love having one foot in reality and one foot in kind of fantasy. All those things were coming together in this, but the biggest challenge for the film was the dark elves.
When Alan joined us, the elves were still taking shape in Malekith, and he went through all the designs that our VizDev team had done, led by Charlie Wynn, and there was this pearl essence mask that Alan immediately connected to. And so he really kind of drove what he wanted them to be, and he was looking for forms that were slightly more elongated. What that was a nice contrast to the power and beefiness of the Frost Giants. So you're talking about a very different species.
You have somebody like Malekith, he's got a history, he's got a unique look that we thought that our VizDev department could develop and translate from the comic book in a cool way.
You know, partly you're drawing on the comics, but there's a limit to what you can pull from the comics. Malekith in the comics looks like a court jester at carnival or a rock star or something.
If you're familiar with the comic book version of Malekith, he's literally like black and red. It's very iconic in that way. And so that's kind of how we started with him.
For us, we had to sort of find something darker and more threatening. And so finding Malekith's look and finding the basic imagery of the Dark Elves was a collaboration, but it was really fun.
He was a long journey. I mean, it may have taken longer for us to get Malekith than it did to get Thor. We first designed the Dark Elves. So we went from the Dark Elves to Malekith. A lot of times, we may start with your main bad guy and then create his pawns. But this time around, it did make sense to just, you know, start with the masses.
Every element of the Dark Elf is created from scratch. There's nothing bought in from anywhere. So right down to their boots, their gloves, everything that they're wearing has been processed here in our special Dark Elf area. It's a kind of a really top secret area. Nobody's seen what's been going on behind these doors. Literally everything has been created. We've had a team of over 100 people putting together all these suits, starting from sculpts, sculpted up all the elements of the undersuit, and then went forward and did all the armor. We did the helmets. The head masks that go on have to be universal, which is a bit of a challenge. Alan was very interested in having a very noble race. We actually designed the mask, so it's tilted slightly further down. So what they have to do is lift their head to be able to see properly. When that happens, their head raises and they become very proud. And Alan was very keen that the mask was kind of neutral in the sense that you couldn't tell whether it's male or female. The expression was quite blank. But if you look closely, there's just a little tint of light that catches the rim, and they can get a little bit mean if they want to. None of them are actually quite the same. There are differences in all of them. So some have more armor than others. The idea behind that was that the upfront elves that come out of the ship to begin with are really armored up, and then behind them is a much darker, less armored version, which are more able to kill by using their hands if they had to. The Dark Elves, as soldiers, that's one thing, but Malekith had a slightly bespoke version. When I usually do a prosthetic, I'm very nervous about losing the actor underneath a pile of prosthetic pieces. So we dealt with a forehead piece, and we have little kind of side pieces that come in here, ears. It sounds like little bits and pieces, but it still takes 3.5 to 4 hours to get into that makeup.
We'll probably be here about 3 a.m. applying that makeup if we're in the first shot at 7. And it also takes a hell of a lot of maintenance during the day. So when I'm not on camera doing a take, I've got at least 4 people in my face or around my body the whole time. So that takes a kind of discipline, but it's worth it. You know, it's a very extraordinary costume made with great care. I wear lenses, I have prosthetics on my face, I wear a wig, I wear a cage on top of the wig, I have body armor, I have a cloak. It's elaborate and transforming. Malekith has a slightly godlike status, the way some leaders do, and Algrim certainly expresses that. He is absolutely loyal to his leader.
Algrim is his right-hand man, who will basically do anything. And so he takes that to the nth degree and sacrifices his life in order to save his own people.
Algrim is a really great character because he goes through a huge transformation, which doesn't just empower him, but it's also tragic, and he's basically weaponized.
And that's where Curse comes in.
We went to great lengths to make sure that the transformation from Algrim to Curse was a transformation that you actually believe, that is organic enough, that you understand that there is an implosion and an explosion. So that was one of the things that was the hardest to achieve in a way that was believable. And I think you see that Algrim is willing to risk and give his life up for what he believes is the better of his people.
It's a great arc because you get to be these fantastic characters. I mean, and they do look very different. Algrim is this very striking, majestic kind of captain of the army. And then Curse becomes this indomitable power of darkness, this force.
This is the curse and Thor fight, and I'm not doing too good.
To play curse, it would take about an hour and a half to put on from top to bottom.
He normally gives a three count, but goes up on one and gives me a wedgie. Yeah. Ready?
One, two, three.
You cannot be a good boy and be playing curse. You're covered head to toe in prosthetics. It's challenging, but the guys did an amazing job in making it flexible because we had to do fight scenes and move about in him.
Are you going to accompany us while we
mask up?
We spoke with Alan about how to maintain Algrim's humanity all the way throughout Curse's transformation. Symbolically, we did that by keeping the same piercing blue eyes.
And that is how we do it.
We liked that Curse became who he was at a cost. You know, there's no stripping off that power. There's no hulking back into Banner. You are what you are, and it's a death sentence. And Adewale just owned him.
One of the things that sort of drove it home and made it feel like we'd done the right thing was when we first saw Curse and the Dark Elves in Iceland, and they were walking in the black volcanic sand with some snow-capped peaks in the background, and their costumes just felt like we were really on Svartalheim.
It had so many of the emotional, the epic, the cosmic, the classic and comic elements that we always search for in our films.
Creating these creatures and the worlds they come from, that's the part that I feel most proud of.